But back on the ketone, since we're back on the ketone, I do want to get to the Lyme disease because it's a topic that I avoid. I've never talked about it.
One I avoid too.
Yeah. So I always have this like knee-jerk reaction because I'm like, the signal-to-noise ratio is so small, and I feel like there's just a lot of confusion.
So much nonsense.
But I'd be really interested because you're a very analytical person. So
try to be.
What your, you know, experience with, well, obviously it's a real disease. People suffer from it. You can observe spirochetes under a microscope. Yeah. So it's definitely real. Mm-hmm. There's just a lot of craziness that seems to be associated with it. But maybe you can talk a little bit about, because you mentioned going on the ketogenic diet to treat your Lyme disease. Can you talk a little bit about like what you found in terms of like your experience with Lyme disease?
Yeah.
How you got to treating it with ketogenesis and...
Yeah, I can talk about it. All right, so where to begin with this? First of all, I'd just like to agree with you and sort of emphasize for everybody that the amount of nonsense and charlatanism out there surrounding Lyme is just beyond belief. I mean, it's just there are so many fraudulent companies and practitioners who are just printing money by either misdiagnosing people with Lyme or treating Lyme in the quackiest of quackery.
Why? I mean, why did they?
Yeah, here's my thinking is that I contracted Lyme on Eastern Long Island, which if you look at the CDC map, right, the Center for Disease Control heat map for Lyme disease, like that is ground zero. Like that's where the bomb went off. And Lyme is named after Lyme, Connecticut. So it's really has historically focused on that sort of northeastern area, Pennsylvania, also upstate New York, Hudson Valley. And I think Lyme has become this popular topic of conversation for a few reasons. Number one, it's poorly understood on a lot of levels. So there are ample opportunities for non-scientists and quacks to sort of invent stories around it.
That makes sense.
Number one. So there's an number two, it's scary. It involves a bug biting you and you catch this disease. So the media loves it. The media writes about it. Then the media, sometimes correctly, often incorrectly, lists the symptoms of Lyme disease. Joint pain, depression, fatigue. It's like, well, that's one out of every two people in the United States at some point every year. So then people go, oh my God, I've had my elbow. Like I got an email from a friend of mine. He said, my shoulder's been bothering me for a couple of weeks. And two of my friends said it might be Lyme. And I'm like, oh my God, it's not. Like I would bet $1,000 it's not Lyme disease. Yeah. Like, given where you live, given the likelihood of having contracted it, it's just so unlikely for most people. Now, all of that having been said, Lyme is a real thing. Like you said, you can observe these spirochetes under a microscope. I think another reason it's popular to talk about is people love saying the word spirochete.
Yeah.
I'm not kidding. They love saying spirochete because they imagine this like screwdriver, like this horribly evil, like maleficent, like spiral bug that like digs into your body, and like the antibiotics come in and they're like, oh no, we're gonna hide from the antibiotics. And it's like, no, it's not that sentient. Like it's not.
my husband's grandmother says spirochetes probably like at least every conversation.
People
I have with
love
her.
Saying spirochetes. Yeah, so you get it.
Yes.
So for all these reasons, it's popular to talk about. I think primarily because the symptoms overlap with a million other conditions. What I came to realize for myself is like, yes, it's a real thing. It's almost certain after Western blot tests, ELISA tests, and looking at all of the diagnostics, which are really primitive, it's very likely that I already had Lyme disease at some point because I've been bitten by ticks hundreds of times. I mean, almost everyone in my immediate family has had Lyme disease. And on Long Island, it's just kind of like, man, suck it up. Like, take some antibiotics, you're fine. Like, doxycycline, move on with life. It's not this big, it's not viewed as like a huge crisis by everyone who gets it on Eastern Long Island because it's so common. So I shrugged it off. I did not get when I was, I took three or four deer ticks that were embedded off of me in the span of 2 or 3 weeks. And, you know, historically hadn't been a big deal. So I was like, well, that sucks. Well, you know, pick it off, make sure the head's not in there, move on. And I did not develop the, what's thought of as the kind of trademark, the trademark bullseye rash. And so I ignored progressively worsening symptoms for 8 weeks where like my joints started getting very sore, swollen, had trouble like getting out of bed in the morning, started getting slow cognitively and had trouble recalling friends' names and just really common words. And eventually got to a point where my system was like, I've seen you sick, I've seen you tired, I've seen you like burning the candle at both ends. This is none of those things.
Yeah,
like, you need to go see a doctor.
Like, it sounds like dementia, like not remembering
friends'
names.
Things are really funny. And if you look at the advanced symptoms of severe Lyme, I mean, it takes on dementia, like, qualities and like even cerebral palsy in some cases, really scary stuff. So long story short, then I get diagnosed with Lyme. And when I walk into the clinic in, you know, on Long Island, to give you an idea of how common it is. So this walk-in kind of emergency clinic open on the weekend, they had a poster up, which was like, hey, allow us to send your blood sample to such and such lab upstate New York to do research on Lyme. And there's a picture of a tick and we'll give you a free $50 Amazon gift card.
Oh
and it's like,
God.
It's that common. But then the question was, okay, I have Lyme. I'm taking doxycycline. I do that for 8 weeks or 12 weeks, whatever it was. I still feel really shitty. Now what? Right? And that's
a long antibiotic course.
Yeah. Well, some people do.
Like,
they take antibiotics for years, yeah. Which I think is not the right thing to do. But this is where I am, and I'll try to sum it up because this can be a very long conversation. I think that there are very, very, very credible scientists and infectious disease specialists who do not believe that chronic Lyme exists. And their position would be there's no evidence that, you know, the whatever it is, the Borrelis blah blah blah, you know, spirochete cannot be eradicated with broad spectrum antibiotics like a doxycycline or something else. There's no evidence to suggest that they like burrow away and hide mm-hmm. and come back, you know, hide in biofilm or whatever.
Yeah, right.
Right. Then you have people, and there aren't that many, but a handful of people who are like, well, it is possible that this Lyme could behave something like herpes simplex, where you have, it's like a recurring infection, essentially, and it takes root in like the nervous system somehow and only comes back out in times of stress, right? There are people, credible doctors who have been like, it's not completely beyond the realm of possibility mm-hmm. that it has some recurring nature. Okay. Still kind of descriptive, not prescriptive. Like, what do we do, right? And then the theory that I kind of came up with, and I'm sure other people have come up with it, but I hadn't read it. I was like, well, let's look at the symptoms of Lyme. You have like depression, fatigue. What are other potential causes after a long course of antibiotics? Well, maybe you just completely scorched earth your microbiome. Among right. other things. So one of my kind of theories is that what people perceive as chronic Lyme is in fact a collection of similar symptoms caused by the long course of antibiotics. So that you should focus on prebiotics, probiotics. I have had a tremendous amount of difficulty, at least as measured in common, say, stool testing mm-hmm. and so on, in repopulating my gut diversity. It's been extremely hard. And I've consumed just about, you know, every type of pre and probiotic imaginable. And I've also tweaked my diet to try to be more favorable for certain types of gut repopulation. It's been really tough. I mean, I did a 3-month intense protocol of all sorts of stuff. So I'd love your thoughts.
Yes.
Did a follow-up stool sample analysis and it was still just like, no, you're fucked. I was like, wow.
So
depressing.
You're talking about measuring your fecal bacteria
yeah.
population using like eubiome.
Right. Yeah, eubiome or, you know, there are other like Rocky Mountain, blah, 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 doctor's data,
okay,
whatever.
Okay, so there's other ones.
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
Well, yeah, I mean, eubiome has, slightly different approach, but
okay.
along those lines, yeah.
I agree with you. For one, it's very, first of all, I heard a podcast you did with Jessica Richmond mm-hmm. from eubiome, and
yep.
I think you had talked about this, and that's
yep.
how I became first aware that the link between, when you mentioned having this hypothesis that you thought possibly some of these symptoms of Lyme disease were a consequence of just complete gut dysbiosis, where you're,
yeah.
you know, you're taking several rounds of antibiotics and you are obliterating, you know, your gut bacteria. A lot of the good ones are going away, and you know, and if you don't take a very strong probiotic immediately after antibiotics, yeah. it repopulates with all the bad stuff, and it's really hard to get, because they take up, they occupy space, and they're sitting in what's called the mucin in the gut, and they have to stick in the mucin to stay. Otherwise, anything you take will just flow through. It's kind of like the flow through.
Yeah.
And so it's really hard to repopulate. I've been doing a lot of self experimentation with I've been using Ubiome to track my gut bacteria, you know, genotypes. But have you tried VSL number 3?
I have it in my fridge right now.
Do you?
Yeah.
Okay, so the sachets are what I recommend, because...
Yeah, I have the capsules.
The sachets have 450 billion, which is more than what the capsules have. 450 billion is like 10 times more than what most probiotics have.
Yep.
The thing about VSL number 3, very interesting. So it's the probiotic that I take. I'm taking it because I've had I've had some gut issues that started in graduate school because I got MRSA.
Mm.
And...
Yeah, that's not fun.
Antibiotics were the prescription, and I had several courses of strong ones.
Yeah.
And finally, it kept coming back, and I was like fed up.
How do you get MRSA?
I don't really know.
What's
how
that?
I got. I worked in a hospital.
Resistant staph.
Yes.
Staph aureus. Aureus.
Damn it.
Staphylococcus. Staphylococcus aureus. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I worked in a children's hospital.
Oh, that's a good place to get it.
They're everywhere in hospitals. So who knows where I got it? Right. I mean, but the point is, I got it, and it sucked. And so. I finally, after like, I don't know, 3 or 4 rounds of antibiotics, I would take it and then go away. And then like a month later, it would come back, and then again and again. And I was like, I can't do this. Like, so I read in the literature that with the help of my husband, Dan, that, you know, garlic and grapefruit seed extract, just a concoction of things. I applied both topically. I made a cream, then I orally took. Hmm. And within 24 hours, I got this thing to come to a head, pus out, and never came back.
Interesting.
So, but as a consequence of all the antibiotic use, I had serious gut issues, led to IBD, and I've been, you know, finally been able to recover, and
IBD, irritable bowel disorder?
Yeah, inflammatory bowel.
Inflammatory bowel disorder.
So, but it's been really, really a long journey and tweaking my diet, and doctors, of course, I went to see doctors, and they were just like, here, take an SSRI, it helps with the pain. And I'm like, I'm not gonna take an SSRI.
Yeah, no thanks.
Yeah, and then like walked out of that doctor. I'm like, I'm not, you're insane. You know, this was like a pelvic pain specialist doctor. Yeah. So I've just had terrible experiences with doctors. And finally I'm like, why aren't you asking me about my diet, fiber, you know, things like that. And so I tweaked my diet and did lots of things, but VSL number 3.
So with the Ubiome testing, have you seen any? I haven't done a follow-up test in a few months, but I have been taking VSL number 3, so now I'm optimistic.
Yes.
Hopefully.
So I did a 30-day VSL number 3 course with the sachets, which are 450 billion, and did a stool test, and I'm still waiting for those results. I've had my husband and I both, Dan, he's done a recent course of antibiotics, and so I had him do his baseline, and then right after, literally like the day he stopped taking antibiotics, did a sample for Ubiome. I got that data back, so I've been looking at that. So I'm gonna talk about all that. It's really complicated, things in the literature are confusing, and some people think some things, and they're actually not true. So I've been looking at other people's Ubiome. Anyways, I'm gonna be doing a series of talks on this, so I'm pretty excited. But
I'll check them out. May I add just a little bit of color on the ketosis.
Yes.
And the color there is, I began looking at fasting as a tool for very many, many different reasons. And whether that be related to, say, longevity or kind of the reason I was excited about it as I was looking at it as basically a reboot for the immune system, even shorter fasts, like 3 days. So I began playing around with fasting, and then, of course, you fast long enough and you go into pretty deep ketosis.
Right.
And so it was almost an accidental discovery for me, whereby I had not been in nutritional ketosis for 10 years, 15 years. I did a lot of experimentation with the cyclical ketogenic diet when I was in college and competing as an athlete. And then I just stopped because it was kind of a pain in the ass and it's really boring. But then I did this fasting to help reboot my immune system, I'll keep it simple. So rebooting my immune system, kicked over into deep ketosis and suddenly felt amazing. And my cognitive function just went through the roof compared to how I had felt up to that point after Lyme disease. And I was like, well, this is very interesting, isn't it? And I said, well, I don't have to fast to be in nutritional ketosis, so let me now play around with ketosis and see what I can discover just by tracking and logging a lot of data. And so I have my kind of the pet hypothesis about the gut biome.
Yes, yeah.
And the antibiotics leading to symptoms that appear to be Lyme when in fact they're caused by something else. Another hypothesis, and the reason I'd like to dig into this, but I haven't come up with a great plausible explanation for this, is that Lyme or the antibiotics or both somehow interfere with carbohydrate metabolism, That's just a starting point. But I've had, because I've been public about the Lyme stuff, because I was incapacitated, I had to tell people. I was like, sorry, not going to reply to your email. I'm archiving 2,000 emails. Sorry. Why? Lyme. And then people started coming out of the woodwork to be like, hey, my wife has Lyme. She's been debilitated. What should we do? What have you learned? And the only advice that I gave a few people is like, look, there's a lot of BS out there. So number one is like, put your thinking cap on and be a good scientist to the extent possible. Number two is try a carb-restricted diet. Try to, and ideally, go into ketosis. All of the people who have gone into ketosis have had the same experience I have. It's a handful of people. The sample size is really small. But these are people who are like, cannot function, had to quit my job type serious cases, go into ketosis, wow, I feel like my old self.
Have you measured any changes in gut bacteria after going into ketosis or after doing the ketogenic diet?
I haven't. That is also, a very interesting topic of discussion, right? So what effect does ketosis have on the gut biome or the repopulation, the rate or the diversity of repopulation? Short answer is I don't know. And part of it is, and this is where maybe I'm just not being a thorough scientist, but I felt it work so well for me. I'm so excited to get back to like building things and creating things and being my old self that I haven't taken the time to dissect it to the extent I probably should. But I'm not sure.
Your carbohydrate, I have this interesting sort of hypothesis that sort of is related. People that have a severe imbalance of gut bacteria, let's say they have a lot less of the commensal bacteria, which is making good, short chain fatty acids and metabolites like lactate that are feeding other good bacteria. They're feeding your gut cells. So you have less of those and you have more of the bacteria that are, say, methane or hydrogen sulfate producing. So you get bloated, more of the, more pathogenic type of bacteria. So you have this overgrowth of bad bacteria. But the thing is that let's say, you eat something that's typically supposed to, be good. Like you eat something like that has a lot of fiber or like vegetables. And so you're getting this fiber that's supposed to be, not digested, but the bacteria can digest it and make it into this good stuff. Well, bad bacteria can digest that as well. So you're feeding this bacteria substrates to make, to keep going and to make more of the bad bacteria. Now, the interesting thing that I don't know is, what there are certain species of bacteria. There's phyla, class species, it's like so incredibly complicated, but certain species only metabolize fat. And I don't know which ones those are and if they're good or bad, or sounds like you've had a positive experience, but that would be really interesting.
It would be.
To measure in general.
Yeah.
But I'm glad you're feeling better. And
the
ketogenic diet is something that I'm interested in diving into and understanding more about.